We're here at the grave of Ollie Freeney in Balgriffin. But Ollie and Cyril Freeney were two of the greatest footballers of the decade of the Dubs, the 1950s. We'll also be going across to see where Johnny Joyce, the man with the golden boot, Simon Behan, the kids from O'Connell's and Joey's who went on to Vincent's to form the great Dubs team of the 1950s. If you look where we panned earlier, that's where the spies were looking in at today's Dubs, training in Fingallion's GAA club. So there's quite a lot of people buried here, but Ollie Freeney, his neighbour in the graveyard, Eamon Andrews, and a few others are where we start.
The Dubs are back, the Dubs are back. Let the railway in, go Bobby, 'cause Hill 16 has never seen the lights of Heffo's army. We'll be marching down from Ringsend and from Ballyfermot too, from East Wall and Marino, to support the boys in blue. For 11 years we've waited, now there's nothing left to prove.
What are they looking at? Why, it's the parade of Dublin supporters from Fairview and Marino en route to Croke Park to take home, they hope, the Sam Maguire Cup for the 16th time. The date, September 28th, 1958. The occasion, the All-Ireland Senior Football Final between Dublin and Derry. Is there room for all? Well, only just. And these enthusiasts are so impatient to get in that they wade the canal and so jump the queue. The Artane boys band led the colourful parade of the teams, Dublin in light blue jerseys, Derry in white and red. Leading the Dublin team was their captain Kevin Heffernan, followed by Marcus Wilson, Ollie Freeney, Johnny Joyce and Paddy O'Flaherty. After a false start due to Kevin Heffernan's enthusiasm, Simon Dagenham got the game going and the battle was on for Ireland's greatest prize. There he is, number 9. Murray to John Timmons. Timmons upfield. Out to Paddy Haughey. A fast sprint by Paddy Haughey down the far wing and across to Kevin Heffernan. Heffernan turns and shoots, and Dublin are 2 points ahead. Dublin won the breakaway at the start of the second half, and John Timmons passed to Ollie Freeney. Freeney back to Timmons. Timmons to Johnny Joyce. Joyce shoots, and Patsy Gormley brings off one of his many brilliant saves. It comes back to Timmons. Paddy Haughey is there. So is referee Simon Dagenham, and the result is a free. The taker, Ollie Freeney, of course, but this time he was out of luck. But again, the relentless Freeney restores Dublin's lead to 3 points, and already the second half is 9 minutes old. But watch for it. Owen Gribben shoots. It comes back to Brian Mullen. He shoots. Charlie Higgins has a go, and Owen Gribben scores a goal. Derry are level, 9 points all. However, the Derry hopes were rudely shattered 2 minutes later. Desi Ferguson sends to Paddy Farnan. Tommy Doherty slips and Farnan beats Patsy Gormley. Dublin are again 3 points ahead. And the 3 points became four when Ollie Freeney scored from this free. John Timmons to Freeney. On to Des Ferguson. I'm afraid. But Ollie Freeney doesn't mind, as he is presented with his 7th point of the afternoon. Then comes the final blow. The centre comes to Johnny Joyce and he coolly crashes home Dublin's 2nd goal, and to make quite certain of it, Paddy Farnan adds it a finishing touch. The game was almost over and the Dublin followers were clearly impatient for the moment to which they had been looking forward for years. But they had to wait until from a Sean O'Connell free, Owen Gribben punched this neat point, which was followed by another from O'Connell before Derry called it a day. But here they come. The Dublin supporters who have seen the Sam Maguire Cup elude their team for 16 years can be justly proud of this great sight.
I think that anyone that has ever heard him will remember him for his the simplicity of his descriptions of what was taking place out on the pitch. And for that alone, he'll be always remembered. No names mentioned, no scandal given, just direct words.
I could place where I was when certain things happened as he described them. For instance, I can recall a famous All-Ireland semi-final between Kerry and Antrim. And apparently the Kerry backs were fairly uncompromising, because he used an expression, and once again, out goes the hand and down goes the man. And I can remember that as clearly as if it were only yesterday it were said. And of course I can remember where I was and who I was with when the All-Ireland was played in New York, which he described so vividly.
At home, I used to build radios. Mm. This was my original interest in radio, was building from the technical end. And the house, well, was always a very sporty house. My father, Lord Mercian, was very interested in sport. And I heard commentaries from England and America and here and everywhere else. And I thought, well, I'd have a go. And I wrote in and asked for a test. And I got the test. It was a National Football League match between Wexford and Louth in Croke Park. And I went along, did it. There were five others tested. And the commentary went back to the GPO, to Radio Air, and to Dr. Kiernan, who was director then, and he asked for the fellow who did the last 5 minutes, would he do the second half? And the fellow that did the last 5 minutes was in his O'Connell school's cap, his O'Connell blazer, and he hasn't shut up since. Well, the first match that I actually broadcast was in Mullingar in 1938, on August the 14th in 1938. Between Galway and Monaghan. I got the large sum of £3.10, and that was to include my expenses to get to Mullingar and back.
From the early hours of that now historic Sunday morning, the crowd streamed to Croke Park. They came from all over Ireland. They came from all over the world. Never before had such a crowd attended any sports fixture in Ireland. Thousands came and failed to gain admission. Every possible vantage point was taken up, and some had come from a land beyond the sea to answer the call of final day. And poor Carney, with his hands on his hips, is walking up to take it. He takes it and sends it rasping into the back of the net. And Mayo are nearer Cavan, but Cavan are still out there in front.
Then quickly you'll come to take it. Calls the Wexford man, sends a high ball well up the field. Oh, a delightful piece of holding there. Holding of the ball by Len Gaynor. Passing it up now to Liam Devaney. Liam Devaney trying to get room to swing his stick. He just can't. Vincent Staples is after him. But he gets his puck in. Well in towards the goal mouth. Quickly blocks it down. And it's a goal! It's a goal!
And then came those pulsating moments. Meade's Paddy Meegan races down the wing. Dodges his way through. A hard shot towards the goal. Morris saves, but Bill Hastie is in, and the ball is in the net for a goal that put me on the highway to football on.
And I wonder, will he be satisfied with the point, with that line of defence in front of him at this stage of the game? I'm sure he will. Let's wait and see. He is not. It's back down. It's a goal!
The ever-active Tom Langan gets the ball in his hand and presses his way through for a goal that does much to put his county on the road to victory.
Look, let's get back to that punch again. Where has that punch been ever since? The punch that knocked Sonny Liston kicking in the first round. Where has it been ever since?
The punch is still here. I used it on Jerry Quarry. I used it on James Ellis. I just changed the name. Then it was the ankle punch. Now it's called the linger on.
The which?
Linger on. It don't knock you out. It just makes you linger on.
Now let's talk about Joe Fraser. That fight in Madison Square Garden, March last year, at the end of that fight, you were not the hero, but the vanquished. How did you feel that night? That's what I thought.
Yeah, that's what you thought. Let me tell you something. I whipped Joe Frazier. Nine rounds, I whipped Joe Frazier. I beat his face unrecognizable.
Yeah, but he hit
He went to the hospital for 1 month. He hit me hard and I fell. Henry Cooper knocked me down. Sonny Banks knocked me down. Billy Daniels knocked me down.
Yeah, but even before he knocked you down, Muhammad, he really hit you that night.
But he couldn't follow it up. I was out on my feet, but I was so great, I came through.
There was one mystery to me that night, was that
You know, we've always looked upon you as the very fast, the man who danced around the ring. You didn't dance that night.
I was off for 3.5 years. I didn't really have the confidence I should have. I didn't know how I would do. I was preserving myself and pacing myself. If you saw me last night with Jerry Quarry, a man who gave me trouble when I first came back, I played with him. I'm totally different now. My timing is back. Joe Frazier's on a chicken farm, retired, fighting nobody's. He's ducking. I'm ready. And the world know I'm ready.
And it breaks to Pat Fitzgerald. He's been chased by two Kilkenny men. He tips it back to Mick Waters, and Mick sends it. Long clearance, well up the field, putting Cork into the attack. The ball in front of the goal. The ball right in front of the goal now. And another shot by John Bennett. And it's a goal! And Mick Reynolds in possession. Well, away he goes. He's gone 10, 20 yards now. Tips it in now to Sean Cleary, who's 40 yards out. Sean into Matty McDonough. Matty McDonough in front of the goal, cutting his way through. Gets his shot in the goal! In the goal! As Mick Morris sends his high ball in towards the centre. Martin Yule kicking it out. Mick Garrett getting ready to draw it and root it way up the field towards Christy Tyrrell. Christy Tyrrell tapping it out to the oncoming Cyril Dunn. Cyril Dunn going right, then left. Now trying to sell more dummies to Seamus Murphy. It's not an easy sale, but he's half succeeding. He has succeeded. Up to Matty McDonough, up and on the right. Matty cutting into the centre. Porter Donahue holding on to him, and there's a free for Donahue. Johnny Cullity in at the goal, anxiously watching to see whether this ball is going to hop or is it going to go over the bar. And it's gone over the bar.
Tommy Drum under pressure. Oh, the attack went so wrong. And the bomber, this is Jack Power, and this is Jack O'Shea, and it's over the bar. And there goes Sam from Paddy to Ambrose.
Arkle and Flying Wilder together. Arkle jumped it in for Flying Wilder's fallen. Arkle is now clear as they turn now to the last fence. Flying Wilder faller at the second last, turning now to the final fence, and it's Arkle cleared of Great Rakes and Volsi. One fence to go. And it's Arkle cleared of Great Rakes. And coming up now, and just listen to this crowd rise to this winner. And here he comes, Arkle, a pat tap, really pushing him out to say, there you are, there's Arkle, and there he is. Arkle and Height of Fashion together. And it's Arkle, just the leader. And in the race home now, it's Arkle. Arkle and Height of Fashion, very little between them. And pat tap pushing Arkle out. Height of Fashion trying to bear him down on him. But racing down now at 50 yards to go, it's Arkle. And coming down to the finishing post. And Rutherford has been hampered, and so has Castle Falls. Rochetta has fallen, Principal has fallen, Dorther has fallen, Curtin Lad has fallen, the Foster has fallen. There's a right pile up. Leasy has climbed over the fence and left his jockey there. And now, with all this mayhem, Born Avon has gone off on his own.
Yeah, Micheal O'Hehir, as he says in the book, his father Jim was very involved. First of all, he trained the Clare team that won the All Ireland before, way back in the early part of the century. He was a Clare man. He trained that team. He also trained the Leitrim football team in the 20s. And Michael played hurling for Vincent's, and he played hurling for UCD. He was never a great football man, although he was a fabulous commentator on football. But hurling, as he suggests himself in the book, was his first love.
No matter what we say by way of adulation or praise or appreciation, it's not adequate to cover what he did, particularly his ability, and this was referred to by several people tonight, of producing a word picture.
It's a sad part, and it was a joyous part, because we had this big launch 2 weeks before he died of Micheal O'Hehir, His Life and Times, the book that was his autobiography. We had a fabulous night. In the end, you had 760 people at a marvellous turnout in the Burlington Hotel. And there was a fabulous parade of players. And as they all waved up to him as he sat on the stage with his family, he really was excited about that.
Finally, I suppose, as we look back on his great career, you could say that Micheal O'Hehir will be remembered long and very pleasantly. Because whenever there's a Gaelic football match being broadcast, or a hurling match, or a race meeting, the memories of Micheal O'Hehir will be very fond and very affectionate.
Referee has blown the whistle, and the game is over!
It's left in a card deck, K.I.T. in a wheelchair, Lonergan, Gillespie.
just a quick message to point out the grave of Micheal O'Hehir here, the great commentator who played his hurling with St. Vincent's and who went on to commentate on 99 All-Irelands. He had a stroke before his 100. He also, like Eamon Andrews across the road, like Sean Oak O'Callaghan, who's buried up there, he also interviewed Muhammad Ali and many of the other great. There's golfers buried here, Paddy Skerritt, Christy O'Connor, there's Liam Toohey, the great soccer player.
Jimmy Morrissey dribbling upfield for Drums, well stopped by Nolan. Nolan. Ambrose. Toohey's clear, Toohey's going to score! There's the first goal of the game, 19 minutes gone in the first half.
Let's remind you of George at his best in his heyday. We're going to show you some of his celebrated goals. Well, a few of his celebrated goals. There were an awful lot of them. And the first goal that you're going to see was your sixth goal against Northampton Town in the FA Cup. He scored six goals in one match. And the first of these goals that you're going to see is the sixth of those. Roll it there, Roisin, please. This is some beautiful, beautiful football of this guy in full belt.
Best. Here's the record. There it is. George Best. Brian Kidd. To George Best. Fitzpatrick. Best going in on it. Best! Oh, beautifully taken by Best! Shot taking over. Best breaking. And in a great position to break too. This looks bad. What a great goal, George Best! Morgan, Ferrand outside him on the right. Doesn't need to use him. Aston trying to set it up for Best! Oh, yes indeed! How about that fella? Best. George Best setting it up for a shot. Here it comes! Oh! George Best! Sadler is up there at the near post. Good back header. Taylor's header. George Best! Kirkpatrick has given the corner and it's been taken. George Best. Sold two dummies and now has made a chance for himself. His hat-trick!
Tributes have been paid to the legendary sports broadcaster Sean O'Callaghan, who has died aged 89. His Sunday night GAA results programme on RTE Radio was one of the longest running sports programmes in the world, putting him in the Guinness Book of Records.
Gemani Dive Cordogwell, Terry and Lanyov. Leinster Senior Football.
The life of Sean O'Callaghan was certainly a full one. He was an actor, an author, and an All-Ireland finalist. But he'll be best remembered for a world record 63-year sports broadcasting career. His results programme on Sunday nights on RTE Radio, familiar to generations. Born in 1923 in Newcastle West in County Limerick, Sean O'Callaghan began his broadcasting life alongside his father, also Sean, in 1948. The same year he played for the beaten Dublin side in the All-Ireland hurling final against Waterford.
I remember particularly because I did score a goal, and the fact of even scoring made it better for me.
And in a twinkling of an eye, the Dublin forwards had the ball in the net.
He was the face, as well as the voice of RTE Sport over many decades.
You're boxing Henry Cooper on the 18th.
Yeah.
Now, what do you think your chances of Henry Cooper?
Well, Henry Cooper's not going but five rounds with me.
He's not going five rounds.
If he goes over five, I won't return to my country for 90 days.
For 90 days.
And if he beats me, I'll retire.
Good man.
The British love affair with Ali began in 1966, after the second Cooper fight.
Ali appeared as a guest on the Eamon Andrews show, alongside Noel Coward, Dudley Moore, and Lucille Ball.
Does it annoy you when people forget and call you Cassius?
in the States and many places, you seem to be looking for trouble. You know, how you doing, Cassius, old boy? How you doing? You know my name, fella. Well, I'm Mr. Lee. I'm sorry.
But let's have a word about the fight last night, Cassius.
Muhammad,
I'm sorry. I didn't do that to you.
Hello, champ, and a very special welcome to your second favorite city of London. So what I can say is a three-time champion of the world, tonight's Muhammad Ali, this is your life. Well done, you see, just born to the man. We've got some lovely surprises for you, very promising. Really enjoyed it. Well, to the greatest I know, they're the greatest. Muhammad Ali, three times heavyweight champion of the world. This is your life.
Thank you.
Would you welcome, please, Phil Lynott?
There he is. Oh, look at that. All showbiz and snaz. Do sit down. Great to see you. How are you?
Cream.
I heard that the white affects the camera.
That'll affect the camera as well. But it makes a nice contrast, makes a nice contrast.
Well, my mother's there. I thought it looks nice.
I know. Looks very well. Your mum, too. We'll be talking to her in a moment. What's this about Gone to Live in Howth? Come on.
Well, it's where the big knobs hang out, don't you know that guy?
Can you see Crumlin from Howth?
No, I wish I could.
Ruins the image, you know, Phil. Ruins the image.
Well, I was looking for a place to live in Ireland. Because, you know, when I moved away, I thought, well, I must come home, you know. Because I really suffer from homesickness. If I don't get back to Dublin, not so much Ireland, Dublin. I'm a real Dubliner. If I don't get back to Dublin within 3 months, then I really start to suffer from homesickness. So when we got married, I sent the wife over and said, see if you like Ireland, and she did. So I sent her looking for a house, and she didn't like the south side because the motorways and all go out that way, you know. So she settled for the north side.
We're here standing in St. Fintan's grave beside the grave of Charles Haughey, the former Prime Minister who won a Dublin Senior Championship medal with Parnells. He is, of course, the brother of the great Pádraic Jock Haughey, who features in this video about the Marino Camino, as does his sister-in-law, Kitty Haughey. Now, in this grave that we're at, we have many GAA greats, like Charlie Haughey, won a medal. We have Frank Cahill, who founded Clannagael, and we also, where we finish, people like Gay Bourne and the rock star Phil Lynott, and of course the great Kevin Heffernan, Heffo. Kevin Heffernan captained the Dublin teams of the 1950s that invented the Dubs brand, and the St. Vincent's on the Marino Camino, from Marino, up along the Malahide Road, they were the people who built the Dubs. The Freeney brothers, Cyril and Ollie, who's buried in Balgriffin. The Foley brothers, Lar and Des, who are buried out in Yellow Walls in Malahide. And across in Fingal, we have the great Johnny Joyce, the man with the golden boot, and we also have Simon Behan, who was also a part of that great Dublin team. We also have great golf players like Christy O'Connor, Paddy Skerritt, and the great soccer player Liam Toohey, who played for Shamrock Rovers, Ireland, and Newcastle United, and who also played hurling in goal for St. Joseph's, where the Dubs came feeding into St. Vincent's GAA. So, one of the big attractions of the Marino Camino, which is from Fairview up along the Malahide Road to Malahide and back around past St. Vincent's here and back to Fairview, is this is where the Dubs brand was made. And it's not just these great sports people, mostly in Gaelic, but also in soccer and rugby and so on, but also the likes of Eamon Andrews, who lived in Portmarnock, who was buried in Balgriffin, who interviewed Muhammad Ali, as did both Micheal O'Hehir and Sean O'Callaghan, who are both buried in Fingal, and the likes of Gay Bourne, who interviewed George Best, as did Eamon Andrews. So on this Marino Camino, there are a lot of sights to see, and a lot of people have contributed to the fabric, which still continues in the various soccer, GAA, rugby and other clubs, which owe so much to Charlie Haughey, to Jock Haughey, to Heffo, to the Freeneys, and to all the rest of them who played Gaelic and put the Dubs on the map.
My goodness me, you boy, how are you? Oh, a surprise entrance, sir. How are you? I'm glad to see you. How are you? You're welcome. You're welcome. Surprise guest indeed. You're very welcome. You've got on the late show at last. You've made your entrance. Why, pray, are you here, sir? Explain yourself.
I am here to present these records to the Dubliners, and I'm here to join you in paying my respects to the Dubliners.
What, sir, would you wish to say to us about them?
Well, I'm delighted to be on the Late Late Show at last, because you kept me off it all these years. And I want to thank the Dubliners for having got me on it at last.
Yes. Yes. And what do you want to say about them? What do they mean to you?
Oh, the Dubliners mean practically everything to me. First of all, they come from my place, Donnycarney, Marino. They remind me of my youth. I love their music. It's the sort of music I was brought up with. I love the ballad, and I think they've really made something very special of the ballad, particularly the Irish ballad. So. There's a great lift to their music. I love it, I enjoy it. It's really my music.
Very encouraging. Marino Walls, you ready, lads?